Hey there, and welcome back to another episode of The Vixen Voice. As you'll know, I love absolutely every episode, but today is power-packed. We have amazing women on here. All of them have touched me in different ways. I will share as we go on. But we have Rabia Ilahi. She is a psychotherapist and energy healer who has her own private practice in Houston, Texas. We have Richelle Carey, an Emmy Award-winning broadcaster, who's also located in the Houston area. And we have Dr. Amy Novotny, who is now coming to us from Portland, Oregon. And Dr. Amy is the founder of the PABR Institute, and she focuses on pain, anxiety, and stress management in naturalistic ways if other things are not working for you, right? So super excited to have all three of you. Obviously, we have super intelligence on this episode, but what we're going to be doing is talking to you from our heart. So today we're going to be talking about the challenges and the different journeys that we've all taken in having children, or in my case, not having children. We're going to talk about different paths we took, and we're going to be sharing our truths. So I know sometimes this can be a painful conversation to hear. I think it's an important conversation that more women need to be having. And as we talk about Richelle's journey, we'll talk about how many women have reached out to her desiring to have this conversation. So what I'd like to share with you is we're all showing up with unconditional love, and we hope that in our stories, you hear that you're not alone, that what you want and need is valid, and that everybody has a different path. So I hope you find inspiration, comfort, or sisterhood in what we're talking about today. So ladies, welcome so much. It's exciting to have all of you here.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us, April.
Well, quickly, I just wanted to share, as I said, each of these women have impacted my life. I'm now 47. And, you know, growing up, I thought I was going to have four kids, the big house, you know, lots of land for them to run around freely. Like, this was, you know, my picture. And I got married early. Unfortunately, my husband had a cocaine addiction that I dealt with. And I obviously was not bringing children into that situation. Went through him cleaning up twice. And on the third go around, I just emotionally, spiritually, and physically couldn't do it anymore. And so divorcing someone that you're in love with, I just understood that I wouldn't survive as a person if I stayed in that situation. So if you've heard the panel in self-love, I think that's my greatest act of self-love. It was the most difficult, but you know, I couldn't be here doing the work I'm doing today had I not made that extremely difficult choice. And you know, that was in my early 30s, and obviously it took some healing to get past that, relationships, etc. And you know, throughout, I've always been like, do I want kids? Don't I want kids? And kind of gone back and forth. And what I will share with you is I find tremendous peace and clarity when I hear other women's stories. So Rabia is here. We met on a plane. Oh my gosh, what, like 10 years ago? I don't know. It's been a bit.
At least.
Yeah. And so we'll share that story. I've been on her podcast before. It was the first one I was ever on. I love that, a couple of years ago. And, you know, when she shared her story of what she, the path she took to have her daughter, it just gave me peace because she was so driven and she knew exactly what she wanted. And I didn't feel that way. And so instead of feeling badly about that, it gave me peace. And I said, okay, you know, if it's meant to be, it's going to be. Or if I'm that driven, I'm going to find a way. And so, Rabia, I don't even know that you understand the impact you had on my life, but it gave me tremendous peace at a time that I had a lot of pain and back and forth.
I didn't know that, April, about how much pain you had had. And, you know, we're talking, chatting on the airplane, and it was such a... You know, I wasn't going to date anyone who didn't want kids. So it was, you know, and I was still single at 40. So I was going to have a kid on my own. And then I met my husband, and we just had a lot of trouble because I was older. And but I think when I had spoken with you, I already had my daughter. Mm-hmm. And I cannot imagine, I didn't know it affected you to that extent, but I was so clear, and maybe that's what you were talking mm-hmm. about. It's the yes. not having clarity. Yep. So, because it is a tough, tough journey for so many of us.
Yeah, I agree. And in fact, I met your daughter when we landed at the airport. So that was really beautiful and nice. And we're going to dig deeper into Rabia's story as we go. And Richelle, I was introduced to you just a couple of months ago. And you've probably already heard from her because she was my second interview for the Vixen Voice. So because she has an inspiring story of, you know, kind of slowing down her broadcasting career so that she could take time to have her son. And so I like to tease her that I always introduce her as broadcaster and boy mom, because it's true. Such an important...
See him right behind me. He's pictures yeah. of Avery all over. This is Avery's place. I just happen to live here because he needs somebody to feed him. So, yes. And it's interesting what you're talking about with Rabia, like some women just yeah. know.
Yes.
I wasn't like that, April. I went, mm-hmm. I just assumed that I wanted kids, right? But I remember that I had a friend, a girlfriend, who she knew the other extreme. She knew she did not want kids. Yeah. And I remember wishing that I knew I didn't want kids so that
interesting.
It would go away and I wouldn't mm-hmm. have to keep worrying about it or having anxiety about it. I was like, I wish I had that kind of clarity that I didn't want kids. And she knew she didn't. And everybody around her has kids and she's great. So it's interesting. Some women have clarity one way or another, mm-hmm. and then some mm-hmm. women really don't know. And then sometimes mm-hmm. it changes over time, and that's okay yeah. too.
Yeah.
No, I totally agree. But thank you. And, you know, sharing your journey, and we'll dig in a little bit more again, was like, you know, you're a couple of years older than me. And I'm like, oh, I can still follow Richelle's path.
I turned 52 3 weeks ago. I'll say it.
Wow. You look fantastic. Love it. Love it. Awesome. And then Dr. Amy, welcome. So we met, oh my gosh, was it like a year ago that we were introduced by a mutual acquaintance?
I think so. I can't remember the exact day. Everything's kind of a blur nowadays. So just go with the flow.
Probably longer than that. So anyway, I love to share how I meet people because I think it's so important to make new connections with amazing women. And, you know, like I said, Richelle, I think I met you on LinkedIn. I was just like, yeah. oh, this woman's cool. Let me reach yeah. out and see if she wants to talk. And yeah. that's literally how we got to know each other.
Very cool.
Yeah. And so I love to share those stories because connection's so important. And we live in a world today where we all want to just go into our own bubble and do our own thing. And I believe in that to a certain degree because I believe in having peace in my life. But I also want amazing, awesome, authentic people. So when I meet them, I want them in my life. So Dr. Amy and I were introduced by a friend of mine who was helping me in the initial stages of Vixen Gathering. And I think she's like one of your best friends, right, Yolanda?
Yeah. Yes, love her.
Yeah, in fact, we're working together again because she's an amazing, yeah. amazing woman. And so at the beginning, I was just chatting with women, seeing what was going on in their life so that we could bring something of value. And so, you know, thank you so much. You just, as busy as you are traveling the world and doing what you're doing, you took an hour to get on a Zoom with me and just share your life experiences and where you were at this point in your life. And we reconnected right at the beginning of your pregnancy, and you were sharing with me that story. And, you know, we'll dig in, but, you know, Dr. Amy just got to a point too where she was like, okay, was kind of waiting on the guy. He's not here. Screw it. I'm having a kid, right? Because she wanted a kid. And I'm quoting her from before we hopped on. So, you know, I just love that. I love that everybody can share their different stories. And I'd love to hear from y'all why you think, and Richelle, I know you're having tons of conversations with women reaching out to you because you have shared your story publicly, right? And I'd love to hear from you, Dr. Amy and Rabia, like how much you share your story and how women react, because I think it's a conversation really important amongst women, because men cannot understand how we viscerally feel about this subject. Like, Richelle, when you and I were talking on our episode, I shared a pregnancy. I hate that we call it a pregnancy scare. Why don't we call it a pregnancy potential blessing, right? It depends on how you think about it. But at a time where I very much was like, okay, I don't want to have kids. Like, that's not part of my life. And then I thought I was pregnant. And, you know, my partner at the time, super supportive. We did the pregnancy test together, comes out negative. And I was like, certain. I had to grieve the fact that I wasn't pregnant, even though I did not want to be pregnant. And it like shocked me, like how it knocked me off my feet. And I suddenly wanted something that I didn't want, or thought I didn't want. Right. So I think there's so many layers to this. And like, just as women, how we're built, we're so viscerally attached to the subject that I don't think anyone else can really fully understand what you're going through. But we as women talking about it, hopefully we can find some comfort. So can you all kind of share your experience, you know, in talking to other women, or how you're able to share your journey, or what the reaction is?
Yeah, I can say that. Oh, I'm sorry, Rabia, you can go.
No, I was scratching. Go ahead.
Yeah, I can say that when I first, I think Avery was probably about a year old, I want to say, when I started publicly, you know, talking about, you know, how I quit my job and I had done egg freezing when I was younger, tried IVF, all that, then ended up adopting Avery. And it was a friend of mine, really good friend of mine, who's also a journalist, who said, she's like, you do realize you're going to have to talk about this. Like, you need to talk about this. And I'm like, what? And she's like, if this were somebody besides you, you would know this was a story. She's like, you're just not seeing it because you're in it. And then when I thought about it, I realized for all of my 40s, I started in my 40s that if like some celebrity or some woman in her 40s, like had a kid, I would read the story. I would want to know how, was it natural? So I'm like, oh, I guess I'm that person now. So I did. She connected me with, I guess the first thing I did was Essence magazine. And then from there, I ended up doing Tamron Hall and all these things. And every single time I talk about it, I get a tremendous response from women messaging me on Instagram or wherever, saying, thank you so much for talking about this. I understand. Or, you know, I've been trying, or, you know, I don't know how to juggle this, that. So yeah, it's been really, it's been a tremendous response. And a lot of women are relating to the fact that I decided to do this single and not keep waiting for, as I say, like this imaginary person that I was giving power over my life, because I didn't want to be a single mom. And I don't, it'd be great to have a partner. But I think the thing that's resonating with women the most is that I stopped waiting and just went and did it.
And actually, Rabia, I'm going to invite you into the conversation here, because this popped into my head. So, you know, actually, years ago, when I had had a pregnancy scare before, I had the same reaction. I mean, my doctor, like, I just started bawling in her office. And then I looked into surrogacy in Texas at that point, because I was just like, okay, at that time, my boyfriend lived in another country. We had totally different lives, right? And I was like, okay, well, I'm just going to do this on my own. And because this is an important point, and you brought this up before, you have to know what the law is where you live. Because when I looked at, I don't know if this is the same and you're much more up to date, but at that time in Texas, it was only protected, a surrogacy contract, for a heterosexual couple who proved they had had trouble conceiving. So as a single woman, the state of Texas would not protect a surrogacy contract for me, and neither for a homosexual couple. So for me, that would be the worst thing, if you're in the middle of surrogacy and then, you know, someone decides they want to keep your baby. And I mean, I might be talking crazy. Maybe that never happens, but it scared me enough not to go down that path. Does that make sense? So I do think it's important to be aware of these things. And you were talking about some things before we hopped on.
So in my case, I was going to do it on my own, and I didn't know I had endometriosis and a septate uterus and all these other things that would have complicated me carrying my own child. And so as I was testing, I started dating someone and he was like, yes, I want to have kids. So we started going through the whole process and I found out I had all of these medical issues, but I still thought I could carry my own child. And so we did go through IVF, got pregnant, and I lost my first daughter at 20 weeks, which was horrible. And that's a whole nother topic. And so then we did get pregnant naturally after that. And I lost that daughter at 18 weeks. And by then, I just couldn't trust my body or my emotions and psyche to go through that again. And so we did look into a gestational carrier, which is, we use the word surrogate. Surrogate is usually someone who's using her own egg.
And thank you.
On a gestational carrier, we're using the uterus, you know, and my youngest sister donated her eggs. So it was my husband's sperm, my youngest sister's eggs. And then we got an agency and got a surrogate, a gestational carrier, and we had to go through a lot of legal stuff. Mm-hmm. We each had to have our own attorneys. There's contracts that, you know, the IVF clinic to get my sister's eggs, like all of that. There were so many legal processes we had to go through and go in front of a judge and sign all kinds of papers saying that the baby would be my husband and mine. But again, I was married. I had a heterosexual marriage. And this was maybe back in 2009, I want to say. And so, but we had to see a psychologist and get all kinds of stuff done. But I wanted desperately to be a mother. So I was going to go through whatever. And I had the privilege of my parents being able to help me financially, because it's incredibly expensive. And I was just privileged in that way, and why I want so much for insurance companies and all to look at making it possible for women who don't have access to be able to grow their families in the way that they can. So, but yeah, now I, and by the time the gestational carrier had my daughter, I was 45. And so my daughter will be 13 on Monday. So I'm 58 now, trying to raise a teenager.
We'll have another episode about that, right? Rochelle will talk about her daughter.
Your whole expression changed.
I'm rolling.
I love that. You know, thank you for sharing those details. And because, I mean, I never even thought through all the complications. And I was a lawyer, right? Like, I did contract litigation. But, you know, you have the psychiatrist, you have the lawyer going in front of the judge. Like, it's so much to go through. And I just think the education on what's involved is super important when you're considering these different routes. And if you don't mind, what I'll share, you said one thing to me on that plane, because you and I are very spiritual, and you said a soul wanted to come through me. Like, you felt there was a soul out there that you were meant to be its mother. And that was the comment that gave me the most peace, because I felt that I would feel that way if that were the case, right? Like, it was that one line that for me, I was like, oh, okay. So until I feel this push that a soul wants me as its mother, I'm good. You know, I mean, it's kind of like what's meant to be. And again, everyone has different beliefs, believes in different things, and we're all made differently. But, you know, for me, that was what brought me peace in talking to you.
You know, as you say that, I because I had lost those two pregnancies, and it was so difficult, you know, and why does God hate me? And like, and I'm not a religious person, but all these things went through my mind. And it wasn't until I started really getting into energy and Chinese medicine. I read this brilliant book called Spirit Babies, because I had always felt like there was a soul. And that book said that the soul comes to you regardless of whether it's through your body, through someone else, you know, do you adopt, do you it just didn't matter, like the soul that's meant for you. And it gave me so much peace because I didn't have to be a mother in one certain way. Like it didn't have to be the way that I thought, you know, and I would not trade the experience, as painful as it was, because it made me so aware of, for me, the process being bigger than me or the physical world. So it just, it was beautifully painful.
Yeah, no, I feel that. And yeah, and you know, you say you're not religious, but you reference God. All of us believe in some different higher power, right? Whatever you call it. I too am not a religious person, but I will talk about God all day long. My best friend talks about the universe, like wherever it's coming to you. Most of us, like you said, believe in something greater than us happening, right? And so, yeah, thank you for that. I really appreciate it. But And that's why I think it's important to listen to things with an open heart for the intention behind it, instead of, you know, I'm the worst one. Sometimes I don't know the right words to use. Thank you for correcting me on gestational carrier. And I think sometimes we don't have these conversations because we're afraid to misstep. But like, if we give each other permission to be human and have a real conversation, we can get so much further. So Dr. Amy, I'd love to hear from you. We've heard snippets of Richelle's story. So Rabia shared her entire story. Could you kind of take us through your journey? And then Richelle, I want you to fill in the holes after Dr. Amy. So, you know, if our listeners can get a real picture of like your journey, that would be amazing.
Sure. I got married young. I didn't have a lot of experience. I grew up in a very, very controlling household with a single mother who didn't let me explore a lot. And so I met one gentleman, thought he was it, got married when I was 23, and it didn't work out. And he wasn't the correct person for me, for our personalities just didn't match. And so I started off, like, felt like a whole new person, new world. And it was very earth-shattering for me to get a divorce. I didn't think I would ever go through that. And I had to learn how to live again. And several boyfriends later, I went through other relationships. I was in another one for on and off for 3 years. That one didn't work out. And it left me having to explore and do a lot of personal development. And I hit 40 and I said, you know what? Okay, screw it. I'm going for it. I had two gentlemen friends, a married couple who had just adopted a little boy, and their story was incredible. On all of a sudden, literally one day, they got a call and said, do you want a baby tomorrow? And the baby was born and they had a baby. And I just hearing about their story, and they had been trying to adopt for 4 or 5 years, and all of a sudden the baby was plopped in their lap by a woman who didn't know she was pregnant. She thought she was having a gallstone issue. So it was literally everything was all of a sudden. I said, you know what? They took a risk. I need to take a risk for myself. I said, I have done things. I have pushed myself all throughout my life in all incredible ways, been all over the world, done crazy things. So why not add one more crazy thing onto my list? And I did. I tried IUI a couple times. Those didn't work. I've heard the success rates are very, very low. It's quite hard to get that to work. So I had one more vial left and I said, this is it. If it's supposed to happen, it will happen. And it all worked out. And I have a 5-month-old little boy.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
So exciting. That's so amazing. If you don't mind, again, I think it's so important to like, know what you're getting into and make good decisions. And when we chatted, you shared something with me that I'd never heard from anyone before. And you shared with me, I think it was IVF that you went through the last time. And again, please correct any details. And you said it was so difficult on your body, but you're blessed with your son. But had it not taken, you weren't sure if you would have done it again. So would you mind just sharing a little bit about that? Because again, you know, I mean, I think we see the highlight reel a lot of times from people like, oh, I did IVF and here's my baby. And, you know, we don't always hear like the difficult part of the journey.
Right. So I grew up in a very chemically laden household. I only ate TV dinners, processed foods, all that growing up. And so in my 20s, I went very clean. And I eventually became organic only vegan person. And that's where I've been for many years, since 2014. So going into first IUI, it was a couple different medications that I could feel the hormonal changes, but it was tolerable. And I was originally didn't even want to consider IVF because I knew it involved injections and a lot of medications and I don't do medications. So going into it, I was like, okay, this literally is my one chance. I am not going through it again. And luckily my fertility levels were very, very good of like a 20 some year old person, even though I was 40 at the time, or yeah, 40 at the time. And so I had to do about 50 different injections into my abdomen at all times. And I'm sure Rabia knows, like you're doing 5 or 6 different medications every day, several in the morning, several in the evening. And you don't know what's up or down. And I held on pretty well just because as long as I knew that there was an effect, something that was causing the emotional swing, I could pretty much mask it or at least not treat anyone else differently because of the medications. But I do remember they got my estrogen, which is normally 20, 30, 40, maybe get up to a couple hundred. It got up to over 6,000 at the height of it, right before they were to do the surgery and get 20 eggs. And so they didn't even give me the full heavy dose of medication that they usually give people. I was on a lower dose, but it was still so traumatic because I'm so sensitive to any type of medication. And just for people listening, I get sick with ibuprofen. Like that's how sensitive I am. Like anything I put in me, I get really sensitive. So it was a big, huge swing. And then to find out when they transferred the embryo that I had to be on more medication, I didn't do my research and due diligence to realize that, okay, most doctors want you to be on medication again, even though fertility wasn't an issue. It was just, I didn't have a male partner. So that was hard. And then the other hard part, which a lot of people don't know, that this was very enlightening to me, is when I came off of the medication at the 12 week mark of the pregnancy, when you come off of progesterone, it usually leads to bleeding. And a lot of women use it as to start their menstrual cycle. Well, a lot of women will bleed during pregnancy because they'll get something called a retroplacental hematoma that comes loose. And so you have bleeding just like a menstrual cycle. And I had that at 12 weeks, but I didn't know that. So I thought I was going through a miscarriage. And so that's why a lot of women can actually go through pregnancy and not know they're pregnant because they have a hematoma. So they can get 5 or 6 months along and not know they're pregnant. And a lot of times we wonder, why in the world does she not know she's pregnant? Well, she may have been bleeding and had a retroplacental hematoma. There's another type of hematoma out there as well. So I had that and it was very traumatic. I mean, I cried so much in 24 hours, more than I had in my entire life, because I was like, this is my once and done. Like, I can't believe this. So just to share that a little bit for any women and even men listening, that if you know someone who's pregnant and they start bleeding, not to say they're not having a miscarriage, but there is some hope.
No, thank you for that. And interestingly enough, I was sharing with Richelle that when my father listened to the first 3 episodes, he was like, oh my gosh, I learned more about women in 3 episodes than my 74 years. On YouTube, we turn 60% men watching this show. So there are men listening, and this is important to understand, right? To be the protector. So thank you for sharing that.
Awesome. I can actually relate to a lot of what Dr. Amy was saying. Like a lot of what you said, like the you know, I did egg freezing at 42. And I'd had a friend mention it to me in my 30s to do it. She worked for a fertility clinic at the time. And I was like, no, it's fine. Whatever. I have time. Well, crossed 40. And I didn't. So I went ahead and froze my eggs at 42, which is, you know, not the best. Ideally, you freeze them when you're younger. But when I did the egg freezing, you know, you were on all these shots and medications, mm-hmm. and then they did the retrieval. And then I ended up, and I don't remember the term for it, but everything went fine in the office. But later on that night, I ended up really painfully bloated, like painfully mm-hmm. bloated. And I went to the ER and I was fine. But what it was is the doctor had, the last few days before the retrieval, had kicked up the doses mm-hmm. of everything. And it just oh, wow. made me like, yeah. So I went to the ER. God, I'm blank. I wish I could remember the name of it because we are trying to educate people. And I was fine.
But oh, that was worry.
A little scary. And then yeah. I actually did the IVF when I was 46. And that was using a sperm donor, again, with all the shots and the medication and all that, doing it alone at that point, just with, you know, my mom helping with shots, et cetera, et cetera. And none of that worked out. But mm-hmm. I was already very realistic and aware of my age and the age of the eggs, mm-hmm. knowing that all this was a long shot. So I was already entertaining the possibility of adoption. So when mm-hmm. the IVF didn't work, I was not devastated. I was sad, mm-hmm. but I wasn't devastated.
Yeah.
But my adoption story is similar to what Dr. Amy described. So I'd actually been approved and I was on a waiting list. And I guess I'd been on, I think I'd been waiting maybe 2 years at that point, I want to say. And I was still living in the Middle East working for Al Jazeera at the time. And then during that time, I quit and moved home. This is the beginning of the pandemic and I was 49 at the time. And then what happened was normally you will get matched with a birth mother while she's pregnant. That's mm-hmm. common, right? Mm-hmm. What happened was my agency called me on a Saturday. I remember I was walking out of the gym and I was in the parking lot and they said, we have a birth mother who came into the agency. The baby has already been born. He's about 6 weeks old. She wants to relinquish. She wants, and we want to show her your adoption profile. But we don't want to show it to her unless you are really in a position to take a baby right away. Because if she likes you, the baby's yours. And I was like, what? Mm-hmm. So they were in Dallas at the time. And I was like, okay, I'll be there tomorrow. So my mom, my dad, and I got in a car, drove to Dallas, met the birth mother. She had Avery with her. His name was not Avery at the time, had Avery with her. Mm-hmm. The adoption people all in a restaurant. I spent a few hours there. Later that night, I told the agency, yes, I want him. And I had him in the like 3 days. So I was on an adoption wait list for years and then ended up with him. Let me think. That was a Sunday. By Wednesday, I went back to Dallas and I physically had him on a Wednesday. So it was crazy. And now he's 2 years, almost 3 years old. He'll be three at the end of January. So.
So what I love about all three of your stories is the courage it took to take the path you took, right? The bravery, the courage going through. And then also for each of you, it worked out. So it's, I know it doesn't work out for everyone, but I think there's this higher thing of trust. I mean, you know, within 3 days you had an adoption, Richelle, you had, and you shared with me when you saw Avery, you knew that was your son, right? Yeah, like he even looks like you and your parents. Like, you know, and Dr. Eby shared it was kind of like her last shot and, you know, hit. And then Rabia, same for you, everything you went through. And I mean, I know how close you are to your daughter and it's mm-hmm. just beautiful and amazing. So I think, you know, one of you, I think Rabia, it was you that said it was, you know, a beautiful pain because mm-hmm. it really teaches you to trust and like persevere yeah. in what you want and that the best will come. And, you know, I feel like for each of you, if you believe in these terms or not, like the correct soul found you, right? You are matched absolutely. To the correct soul. Yeah. And yeah. it's just a beautiful story to see how different things can happen.
You know, I thought about something Amy said too.
Yeah.
That, and I've said this before in previous chats, exactly that, you know, I kept waiting, you know, because I wanted to be married, blah, blah, blah. But then mm-hmm. I realized, I had this epiphany where I realized I have done big things on my own my whole life.
Yes.
You know, yeah. whether it's chasing jobs, moving to the Middle East, I've done so many things alone. So like, what was I waiting on? And you said something similar to that, Amy, that you were like, I've been courageous and done so many other things. Why can't I do this myself?
Yeah.
So I'm sorry, please, Amy, go.
I was just gonna say one of the kind of along with what Richelle was saying, so one of my mantras for life, and since I've been very little, is whatever the hardest path is, go through it. Mm-hmm. And I know and it's not that I consciously think that, but there has been parts of my life where that's literally always the path I chose, more to see, can I go through it? And do I want to just experience what I can in life for my journey? And mm-hmm. for me, motherhood was, yeah, I do want to experience it. I hear what people are saying about this love. I hear what they're saying about this devotion towards another life, but I don't really get it. And I didn't get it until he was in my arms.
Yeah.
And then when I couldn't stop crying, I finally got it. Yeah. And it's still an emotional roller coaster. And I look down at him every single freaking day. And I'm like, whoa, I got lucky on this one. I really got lucky. And even like changing diapers, like I don't mind. Never once have I minded. I'm like, cause he also had some kidney issues. And so there was a scare with he was going to be born and all that. And I'm like, awesome, bring on the poopy diapers. I'm like, you let it rip, little one, you let it go, Wesley. And I just keep celebrating.
So very quickly, Dr. Amy, I agree. I always say whatever scares me, I need to do because I'm not scared of much, right? So if there's something I'm scared of, like it means it's the direction I need to go in. But, you know, what I'm curious both from you and Richelle and also Rabia is when you both said I've done other things, what was maybe the hesitation prior to that to do this? Or what was like kind of that moment where you're like, okay, this is it, the timing's right? I mean, because for all of you, there became a certain time and you're like, okay, I'm just doing this. So what do you think was the switch for you? Because I'm sure plenty of women are listening going, gosh, yeah, I want, but I don't know. I mean, we all put ourselves in that holding pattern. So I guess what helped you get out of the holding pattern or moved you forward?
Well, for me, it was when I turned 40. Mm. Like, okay, I'm going to do this on my own because I didn't have a partner, mm-hmm. you know, but I think it was that turning 40 where I felt like I don't have to apologize mm-hmm. to anyone. And I'm a first generation immigrant from a Muslim family. Mm-hmm. So, and the fact that my dad kind of had my back, he was encouraging mm-hmm. me and shocking. so it was like, how will I be seen, judged? But then when he was on board, I just felt like I don't need to apologize to anyone for what I want in life, single or not. Like it just, this is my life. Mm-hmm. So it was turning 40, I think.
I would say mm-hmm. similar. The 40s was like a symbolic thing for me. Like 40s mm-hmm. is when I did egg freezing, and even the egg freezing was just me trying to buy more time because what was holding me back is that I did want a traditional family. I did want to be married mm-hmm. and I didn't want to be a single mom. And not necessarily because of what people thought about me. I just didn't want to do this on my own. Yeah. And then what ended up happening was I ended up in a relationship that was just a disaster. And when mm-hmm. I got out of that, I was like, I don't have time to keep doing this BS. And I was making good money. And I was like, what exactly am I waiting on at this point? And then I was like, you know, I can park all that relationship stuff. It doesn't mean it's never going to happen, but it mm-hmm. it's like now or never. The clock was just ticking.
Well, and there's a certain place where you become at peace with relationships. So we were doing that vision board I shared with y'all today with my Vixen mastermind. And one was like rating your different levels of your life, a scale of 1 to 10, like a check-in, right? Mm-hmm. And significant other, I put a 10. Like it just popped in my head. I don't have a significant other. I have no prospects right now. And I put a 10. And I was like, because I don't care. Like, yes. I mean, not that I don't want someone, but yes. I don't care. I have a phenomenal, great yep. life and yeah. I'm waiting to be discovered. Like, I know, like he's around the corner. I'm not searching for him. Like, you know, I believe in God. God's Amen. Sending him to me. I just have to be happy and live my life. And so Yeah, I think, you know, it's interesting. It comes for all of us in a different way, but that was kind of shocking. And Dr. Amy, sorry, you were going to share something.
That's perfect timing, because I was going to say something very similar that ties in with that is, as soon as I decided to make that decision to have a child, all the dating pressure went whoop right out the door.
Yes.
And I no longer felt like I was settling or trying to make something work when it just wasn't the right fit. And and I haven't dated since I was pregnant. And I'm like, I have a little boy in my life, and he takes all of my energy, all of my spontaneity, everything. I don't have the resources right now to devote to a partner, any man that would come into my life. And so I'm like, you know what? That's okay. But when that does happen, there's no pressure. I can fully be myself at all times because there is no attempt to see, okay, is this going to be my right partner to have a child with? And we have to hurry it up because my biological clock is ticking. You don't have to worry about any of that. I can say, hey, let's just enjoy ourselves. And if it's the right fit, it is.
Yeah, it's so crazy because you all talk about going in your 40s. I'm 47 and I still think I'm 27. I don't know. I have a mental problem. I'm like, I have plenty of time. My doctor's like, you're perfectly healthy. Don't worry about it. And I'm like, okay. So, I mean, everybody's on different paths. Sorry, Rabia.
Well, Dr. Amy, what you were saying about when you got clear on that, and you too, Richelle, like the dating part just sort of, it doesn't matter. You know, because there's this other thing that's all encompassing. And I was actually friends with my husband when I was going through all of this. And so I wasn't thinking this is the guy, you know, he was my friend, but the way he showed up in my surgeries and all of that, that's when I thought, oh no, you know, why not? And so, but yes, I think if I had been worried about a relationship, it wouldn't have happened.
Yep, absolutely.
I just had to pick, and I wanted to be a mom more.
Yeah.
Interesting. Absolutely. No, thank you for that. And, you know, to be clear, none of us are saying we don't want men in our lives. So we're here. We're just saying... They we don't need men to make us whole. Yes. I love it. And if you want fun dating humor, follow Richelle on Instagram, either being a mom of a toddler or dating. Like, I love, she'll post like, how in the world am I going to date when I go to bed at 8 o'clock? Things like that. I'm like, check, me too. Like, I'm like,
he goes to bed, I go to bed right after him, or at least I get in the bed right after him. And I don't, and this is, and I don't know if anyone else, like, we're all at different places. Rabia, you're married, and Amy, you already said you're not in the dating space, but, and I wasn't when he was 5 months, but I'm still not really now. But the problem with that is I actually do think I want a partner, I think, but it's just, I can't, it's hard for me to make myself care.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? I feel like I gotta try, but I just don't feel like trying. I don't know.
I actually think differently. I don't think we have to try, but I think you have to be ready for it and have your discernment clear when it walks in your life. So like Rabia said, that was her friend. And then suddenly she's like, oh, this guy's pretty supportive and cool. And she started seeing him a different way. I mean, you know, I think most of us in our life have had that friend that we thought was secure in the friend category. Maybe they didn't become a husband, but suddenly you look at them differently one day and you're like, oh, well, you're a pretty great guy. Like, I mean, you know, I don't know. That's what online dating and all of that took so much spontaneity out of things. God. I love this just like chemistry of meeting someone. And then I was like, gosh, I hop from relationship to relationship. I mean, I've been in multiple like long-term relationships since 2017. And I just came out and I'm like, I haven't dated since 2017, like, even though I'm not married, because every time I got single, another guy showed up. And I was just like, what does dating even look like? So I'm like, yeah, you know what? They'll just show up when it's time.
And just kind of on your topic, too, like when you're saying we're not bashing men, and by means, no, I wish my little boy had a father by all means. And part of me going through this, especially, they call it a single mother by choice, is kind of a term that's becoming more and more popular. There is a lot of talk about how do you have these male relationships in your child's life just to supplement, because they don't have a this father figure with them if you're single. And so I've been very, very lucky. I have quite a few men friends in my life. They're married. Okay. Some are single, some are married. But he has so many different uncle so-and-sos because I want him to have these male bonds. And so many of the guy friends in my life, they all just reach out. We can't wait to take him out learning how to burp or go fishing or sailing or whatever it is. And because that was really hard to make this decision. Yes, I wanted to be a mother. And one of the first things I have to do is apologize to my child. I'm sorry you don't have a father, because I do think it's so critical. And I wish my life had been different for that reason. But I also don't want to change anything in my life because I wouldn't have Wesley the way he is. So men out there listening know, we think you are absolutely 100% critical, important in everything, in every way. And unfortunately, I just didn't find the right one to make it happen naturally. So
I agree, I've been very fortunate that my dad, Avery, spends at least one night, if not two nights a week, with my parents. My dad is extremely present for him, for exactly what you said, Amy. Like, I feel like I have to be intentional to make sure that he does have that presence. And he actually calls my dad Dada. We're transitioning into him calling him Papa. But I feel like I owe it to him. We owe it to our kids to be intentional that they have that presence as well. Because, you know, just because we chose this, they didn't choose this.
You know, I have some of my male clients in my practice, and I think we don't talk about this that much. They are dying to be fathers.
Yes.
But they can't do it on their own. You know, and so they are like just dating, looking for the right woman, and they want to be husbands and fathers. And or even if they're looking for the right man, they want to be fathers, you know. And so I wish we would bring that up more so that it wouldn't be just a woman wanting to be a mom. There are so many men that want to be dads.
No, I totally agree.
Yeah.
Well, I apologize, ladies. I would love to talk to you all day, but I know we have a time press. So before we log off, you know, I always like to just end by saying the world needs more love and asking our audience how they can show up with love today. So would each of you like to share a little message quickly? And then we are going to sign off for the day. And please, if you like this episode and you want to hear more of this, let us know. Go back, listen to my episode with Richelle where we dig deeper into this. And we're happy to go down this path further in the future. So let us know in the comments, share your reviews, share your feedback. You can reach us at team@vixengathering.com. If you want to communicate directly with us, we would love to hear from you. And the best way is to subscribe to the Vixen Voice on our website. So any resources we mentioned are sent directly to you. All right, ladies. Quick message for the audience. And again, thank you all. I really love that you showed up, you know, 200%, like all three of you always do, but sharing your story and being real and being vulnerable. I love it. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we would all say that probably, I think a good takeaway is you don't know what your life is going to be. Be open to every possibility. Because I'm thinking any of us would have chosen this path to becoming a mother, but I know we're all really happy where we are. So just be open.
I will add to that know that you're loved unconditionally and that everything really does. What has saved me is believing everything has happened for me because I am loved. So,
and I'll just say you have one life to live. Go for it.
Love it. All right, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you, ladies, for showing up in all of your beautiful glory. Have a wonderful day, and we will talk to you soon.
Bye.